Good morning, and welcome to our worship service on this fifth Sunday of Easter. I want to welcome all that are viewing us today. We want to thank Pastor Chris for being our videographer today. We thank John for going through and editing our work, and we thank you for being with us in this service. We begin with a confession and forgiveness. Blessed be the Holy Trinity. One God who forgives all of our sins, whose mercy endures forever. Amen. God of all mercy and consolation, come to the help of your people, turning us from our sin to live for you alone. Give us the power of your Holy Spirit that we may confess our sin, receive your forgiveness, and grow into the fullness of Jesus Christ, our Savior and Lord. Amen. Let us confess our sins in the presence of God and one another. Most merciful God, we confess that we are captive to sin and cannot free ourselves. We have sinned against you in thought, word, and deed by what we have done and by what we have left undone. We have not loved you with our whole heart. We have not loved our neighbors as ourselves. For the sake of your Son, Jesus Christ, have mercy on us. Forgive us, renew us, and lead us so that we may delight in your will and walk in your ways to the glory of your holy name. Amen. In the mercy of Almighty God, Jesus Christ was given to die for us. And for his sake, God forgives us all of our sins. As a called and ordained minister of the Church of Christ, and by his authority, I therefore declare to you your entire forgiveness of all your sins in the name of the Father, and the Son, and the Holy Spirit. Amen. Grace of our Lord Jesus Christ, the love of God, and the communion of the Holy Spirit be with you all, and also with you. Let us pray. Almighty God, your Son, Jesus Christ, is the way, the truth, and the life. Give us grace to love one another, to follow in the ways of his commandments, and to share his risen life with all the world. For he lives and reigns with you in the Holy Spirit, one God, now and forever. Amen. Our first reading for this fifth Sunday of Easter comes from the book of Acts, the 7th chapter. Filled with the Holy Spirit, Stephen gazed into heaven and saw that the glory of God and Jesus standing at the right hand of God. "Look," he said, "I see the heavens open and the Son of Man standing at the right hand of God." But they covered their ears and with a loud shout all rushed together against him. Then they dragged him out of the city and began to stone him. And the witnesses laid their coats at the feet of the young man called Saul. While they were stoning Stephen, he prayed, "Lord Jesus, receive my spirit." Then he knelt down and cried out in a loud voice, "Lord, do not hold the sin against them." When he had said this, he died. This is the word of the Lord. Thanks be to God. Our psalm for the day comes from the 31st Psalm, verses 1 through 5 and 15 through 16. "In you, O Lord, I seek refuge. Do not let me ever be put to shame. In your righteousness, deliver me. Incline your ear to me. Rescue me speedily. Be a rock of refuge for me, a strong fortress to save me. You are indeed my rock and my fortress. For your name's sake, lead me and guide me. Take me out to the net that is hidden from me, for you are my refuge. Into your hands I commit my spirit. You have redeemed me, O Lord, faithful God. My times are in your hand. Deliver me from the hand of my enemies and persecutors. Let your face shine upon your servant. Save me in your steadfast love." And our second reading comes from 1 Peter, the 2nd chapter. "Like newborn infants, long for the pure spiritual milk, so that by it you may grow into salvation, if indeed you have tasted that the Lord is good. Come to him, a living stone, though rejected by mortals, yet chosen and precious in God's sight. And like living stones, let yourself be built into a spiritual house to be a holy priesthood, to offer spiritual sacrifices acceptable to God through Jesus Christ. For it stands in Scripture, 'See, I am laying in Zion a stone, a cornerstone, chosen and precious, and whoever believes in him will not be put to shame.' To you then who believe in him, he is precious. But for those who do not believe, the stone that the builders rejected has become the very head of the corner, and a stone that makes them stumble and a rock that makes them fall. They stumble because they disobey the word as they were destined to do. But you are a chosen race, a royal priesthood, a holy nation, God's own people, in order that you may proclaim the mighty acts of him who called you out of darkness into the marvelous light. Once you were not a people, but now you are God's people. Once you had not received mercy, but now you have received mercy." This is the word of the Lord. Thanks be to God. Gospel according to John, the 14th chapter. Glory to you, O Lord. Do not let your hearts be troubled. Believe in God, believe also in me. In my Father's house there are many dwelling places. If it were not so, would I have told you that I go and prepare a place for you? And if I go and prepare a place for you, I will come again and I will take you to myself, so that where I am, there you may be also. And you know the place where I'm going. Thomas said to him, Lord, we do not know where you're going. How can we know the way? And Jesus said to him, I am the way, the truth, and the life. No one comes to the Father except through me. If you know me, you will know my Father also. From now on, you know him and have seen him. Philip said to Jesus, Lord, show us the Father, and we will be satisfied. Jesus said to him, Have I been with you all this time, Philip, and you still do not know me? Whoever has seen me has seen the Father. How can you say, show us the Father? Do you not believe that I am the Father and the Father is in me? The words that I say to you, I do not speak on my own, but the Father who dwells in me does his works. Believe me that I am in the Father and the Father is in me. But if you do not believe, then believe me because of the works themselves. Very truly, I tell you, the one who believes in me will also do the works that I do, and in fact will do greater works than these because I am going to the Father. I will do whatever you ask in my name so that the Father may be glorified in the Son. If in my name you ask me for anything, I will do it. This is the word of the Lord. Praise to you, O Christ. Dear sisters and brothers in Christ, grace, mercy, and peace to you from God our Father and Jesus Christ, our risen Savior. Amen. If you could only ask God one question, what would that question be? You know, questions are an essential for our everyday conversations as they so often serve as an invitation to dialogue and provide opportunities for further learning and investigation into our feelings and emotions. It's little wonder then that questions sit at the center of John's gospel. From early on in the gospel story, we find John asking questions by way of his biblical characters. In the first chapter of John's gospel, it's Andrew, a disciple, who asked Jesus where he's staying. Two chapters later, Nicodemus inquires, how does a man go back into his mother to be born again? Then we go to the fourth chapter, and a Samaritan woman wants to know where she can get some of that living water. And on it goes as Peter and Pilate and numerous others all ask Jesus questions that in turn give him a chance to teach more deeply the truth that he's come to reveal. But of all the questions in John's gospel, the ones asked in today's reading from the 14th chapter may just be the most difficult questions and possibly the most consequential of all. So maybe I need to illustrate where I'm going with this just a little bit. Today's gospel reading takes place on the Thursday evening before Good Friday. It's Maundy Thursday, if you will. The night before Jesus' crucifixion. In John's account, Jesus not only knows that he will soon be leaving this world, but he attempts to prepare his disciples for all the events that are about to transpire. In fact, after the Last Supper that he shares with his 12 friends, Jesus spends the next four chapters of John's gospel talking about his departure that is soon to come. And these verses are part of, and in fact, come right at the beginning of a long and dramatic scene that's going to be taking place. It was just a few moments before today's gospel text that Jesus told the 12 that one of them that is sitting with him at the table would betray him. And then he shares with Peter that Peter would not only deny him once or twice, but three times within the next number of hours. It's in this situation that Jesus then says to his remaining disciples, do not let your hearts be troubled. And you can almost hear each of his disciples saying, what? Do not let your hearts be troubled? Are you kidding me? You've just told us that you're going to die and one of us is going to betray you and another of us is going to deny you. I have no doubts that most of us here, no, I think all of us here can understand what those followers of Jesus are kind of now thinking about. I can even imagine that some of us have had those kind of moments when our hearts were not only deeply troubled, but downright disturbed and maybe grief-stricken. Yet in John's gospel, Jesus asks his disciples to not only believe in him, but to trust him and to commit their futures to him. And then while the disciples are still in this state of angst, he starts talking about going away, preparing places, and then coming back. As if to add injury to insult, he implies that they all should have a clue as to what he's talking about. In fact, he actually says, "You know the way I'm going. Just follow that way." To which Thomas, doubting Thomas, asks another of the Johannine questions. "But Jesus, we don't know where you're going. How can we know the way?" To which Jesus responds that he is the way and asks them again to trust him. But then we have the question from Philip, who's sitting there anxiously listening to this dialogue, and he asks the question, or maybe it's a plea, that no Jew would ever ask. Philip says, "Jesus, show us the Father and we will be satisfied." Or to put it in a better way, "Jesus, tell us what God looks like." Now, that's not what John says in his gospel, but I've got to believe that that's where all the disciples' minds are when Philip asks this hard, difficult question. You see, in ancient Israel, it was a religious understanding that no one can ever see God. The Old Testament superstar Moses was once put in that situation where he could see God, possibly. But God told him, "Set your face into the cleft of a mountain, and when I pass by, you won't see me, but you'll see the brightness, the glory of the Lord." And when Moses was finally allowed to turn around after God had passed by, what Moses ultimately saw was the tail of God's glory, or according to the Hebrew, Moses could only see God's backside. You see, God is too much for us to bear, too holy, too powerful, too full of potential in life and the future for any mortal to behold. And yet here we have Philip asking Jesus to tell us what God is all about. Tell us what he looks like. "If you want us to trust you, Jesus, just show us the Father. Just tell us what God looks like." It was a disrespectful, inappropriate question, and yet I'm guessing that we can understand maybe where Philip is coming from. Because I think a good number of us have been there at our wits' end, desperate for some hope that things are going to get better, begging for some kind of reason to believe that a situation, a tragedy, a disaster is not going to overtake us. Maybe it's when the doctor comes and tells you that your cancer has returned, or that your vision is going to continue to diminish. Or maybe it's when a loved one dies and you are at that place where you just can't see a future. Or maybe for way too many of us, it's at a school shooting and you're asked, "God, when will this end?" Each and every one of us have had that moment where we want some reassurance, some glimmer of hope that all that we had heard and learned about God is not just some kind of false story. "Just show us the Father and we will be satisfied," Philip says. To which Jesus responds, not in frustration, but in love, "Have I been with you all this time and yet you do not know me? Whoever has seen me has seen the Father." Which then takes us back to the very beginning of John's gospel, when the author of the gospel shares these poetic verses about the Word that was there at the beginning. the Word that is God, the Word that is flesh, comes and dwells among us. Well, after all that, John closes this portion of this gospel by reminding us that no one has seen God but the Son. They have seen the Son. And there's the truth of this gospel. First, that no one has seen God, and that's hard, sometimes unbelievably hard, to believe, to trust, to have faith when we can't see God. And yet, we have the second truth. Jesus, the Son of God, the Word that became flesh. If you've seen Him, you understand who God is. We know what God looks like by understanding the Son. But keep in mind that in this gospel story that John gifted us, it's on the eve of the crucifixion. And Jesus is about to be betrayed, abandoned, handed over, tried, insulted, beaten, and then crucified, nailed to a cross, where He dies His human life. And why? To appease the righteous anger of a just God, or to set some kind of example of what real faith is supposed to look like, or to take the punishment that we deserve upon His shoulders? No, none of those. Rather, Jesus goes to the cross for one reason: to show us God, to share with us God's grace and mercy, to let us know just how much God loves us and how far God will go to communicate that love for us. Jesus goes to the cross so that we might believe, and in believing we will have life in His name. What that could mean for us here at Faith in Bethany is that God is ready for our questions, even our most difficult questions. For our God can handle all of our life issues. And in fact, God wants to hear us tell Him those issues. And when we are at our wits' end, when our hearts are troubled and our blood pressure is rising to levels that we don't want it to be at, remember that Jesus has come to show us the way. For He is the one who preached mercy and taught God's love. He's the one who healed the sick and opened the eyes of the blind, let the lame to walk, conquered death so that the grave no longer has the last word. He did it so that what we see in Jesus, we understand, is what God looks like. It's who God is. Love. Perfect love for you, for me, for this world. Amen.
Oh,
Living together in trust and hope, we affirm our faith using the words of the Apostles' Creed. I believe in God, the Father Almighty, creator of heaven and earth. I believe in Jesus Christ, God's only Son, our Lord, who was conceived by the Holy Spirit, born of the Virgin Mary, suffered under Pontius Pilate, was crucified, died, and was buried. He descended to the dead. And on the third day, he rose again. He ascended into heaven. He is seated at the right hand of the Father, and he will come to judge the living and the dead. I believe in the Holy Spirit, the Holy Catholic Church, the communion of saints, the forgiveness of sins, the resurrection of the body, and the life everlasting. Amen. United in the hope and joy of the resurrection, let us pray for the church, the world, and all in need. God of life, strengthen your church to proclaim your gospel even in times of trouble. Bless all who share your word and strengthen them for the bridge-building ministry between church and world. Lord, in your mercy, hear our prayer. Creating God, you show your steadfast love through mighty waters, towering mountains, verdant fields, and arid deserts. Protect the earth's diversity from the forces of pollution, erosion, extinction, and global warming. Lord, in your mercy, hear our prayer. Mighty God, your Spirit guides us into all truth. Give wisdom to the world and to local leaders and to organizations as they begin to build and renew relationship. Strengthen leaders and aid organizations in areas needing to be rebuilt following conflict, unrest, or natural disaster. Lord, in your mercy, hear our prayer. Loving God, you make your home among us. Abide with refugees, those experiencing homelessness, those fleeing war and poverty, and all who question if there is a home in your heart for them. We pray for all who are sick and in need of your healing presence. Lord, in your mercy, hear our prayer. Assuring God, you accompany your people amid uncertainty and change. Uphold people in this community who have recently moved, changed jobs or schools, retired or are going through transitions in life of any kind. Lead us in your way, O Lord. Lord, in your mercy, hear our prayer. Renewing God, you gather the saints at your heavenly banquet. We give you thanks for the care shown us by those who have gone before us. Grant confidence and comfort for all awaiting the place you have prepared. Lord, in your mercy, hear our prayer. Rejoicing in the victory of Jesus Christ and the resurrection, we lift up our prayers and praise to you, Almighty and Eternal God, through Jesus Christ, our risen Lord. Amen. The peace of Christ be with you always. Let us share the peace with one another.
We now have a time of offering where we take the gifts that God has given us and we share them. We share them with the church and we share them with the world in need. And so thank you for your gifts to your church.
Let us pray. Blessed are you, O God, ruler of heaven and earth. Day by day you shower us with blessings. As you have raised us to new life in Christ, give us glad and generous hearts, ready to praise you and respond to those in need through Jesus Christ, our Savior and Lord. Amen. The Lord be with you.
And also with you.
Lift up your hearts.
We lift them to the Lord.
And let us give thanks to the Lord our God.
It is right to give our thanks and praise.
It is indeed right, our duty and our joy, that we should at all times and in all places give thanks and praise to you, Almighty and merciful God, for the glorious resurrection of our Savior Jesus Christ, the true Paschal Lamb who gave himself to take away our sin, who in dying has destroyed death and in rising has brought us to eternal life. And so with Mary Magdalene and Peter and all the witnesses of the resurrection, with earth and sea and all the creatures, and with angels and archangels, cherubims and seraphims, we praise your name and join their unending hymn. It was betrayed, our Lord Jesus took the bread, gave thanks, and gave for all to eat, saying, take and eat, this is my body given for you, do this in remembrance of me. Again, after supper, he took the cup, gave thanks, and gave for all to drink, saying, this cup is a new covenant to my blood shed for you and for all people for the forgiveness of sin. Do this in remembrance of me. Our Father, which art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread and forgive us our trespasses as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom and the power and the glory forever and ever. Amen. Come and know Christ, broken and poured out for you. Let us pray. God of abundance, with this bread of life and cup of salvation, you have united us with Christ, making us one with all your people. Now send us forth in the power of your Spirit that we may proclaim your redeeming love to the world and continue forever in the risen life of Jesus Christ, our Lord. Amen. And now receive the Lord's blessing. The Lord bless you and keep you. The Lord's face shine upon you and be gracious to you. The Lord look upon you with favor and give you peace. In the name of the Father, and the Son, and the Holy Spirit. Amen. Thank you. Go in peace, share the good news. Thanks be to God.